reason for fiscal deficits. First, let us be very clear that the theoretical reason has nothing to do with Keynes. Nothing. How many of you have heard of an economist called Mikhail Kalinsky? Okay, you don't have to worry about it. Just read me. Kalinsky's useful thing was he refused ever to talk about an economy. Okay, he was a Marxist, so he was very misguided in many things he did, in my opinion. But that fundamental insight he had, he talked about capitalist economies, socialist economies, mixed economies, and he wrote separate macroeconomic books for them. And in a mixed economy, capitalist comes socialist, and then in a developing economy, if you like, what is the objective of a state, of government? Now, economics won't help you. My thesis, by the way, was on the politics of fiscal policy. So I'm going to go back a bit into that and ask you, why does the Indian state exist? Vikas state hai. So why do we have a 1.2 million strong army? If it's a state that is there to guide our borders, then what are we doing wasting time on open defecation? So the answer obviously is more complex. I mean, you know, when you define a state and its objectives, then you have to look at the objectives of the state in terms of the priorities it gives for different kinds of expenditure. And broadly in public finance, we have two separate theories which are reflected in how we present as economists public finance statistics that define what a state does. And this public finance has had to do. Public finance is very interesting. It's an intersection between finance administrators, lawyers actually, public finance economists, and political scientists. One can't do without the other. Good public finance. Not the crap you read in the Journal of Public Economics, but good public finance. You know, the stuff you read in CS, applied journals, policy journals, you never get good public finance unless these four communities talk to each other and have a shared understanding. So the shared understanding in public finance, and I commend this to you, comes from something called the economic and functional classification, which actually is an attempt to do what economists could not do, but to tell you why the state exists and to measure what the state is doing for relative different parts of its activity. But the one thing we do know, and that is why I think Keynes is irrelevant to a developing country, not Keynes in economics necessarily, but Keynes, is that the state, that India is not an economy which has ever been at full employment in the Keynesian sense of the term. India has always been at full employment in the sense that in India, since if you don't do something, you will die. So everybody's employed. That's why the unemployment rate in that sense is very low. But it's not an economy that has seen a, well, unless you want to go back to, I don't know, the Mughals or those guys who invented the internet 5,000 years ago. That time I don't know. But in the last 40, 50 years, you can't really sort of say that the Indian economy has to go back to a level where it was. Right? We're always trying to go somewhere where we have not been. And that is not what Keynes was about. Either in the general theory or how to pay for the poor. Right? So what is this place where we want to go? That is an economic aspiration, and that economic aspiration is paraphrased in the term developing transformation. Now that has many elements to it. It has a political element, economic element, sociological element, but in economic terms, that basically involves a sustainable increase in the economic standard of living of the vast majority of Indians on a continuous basis until such time as that standard of living, the way I define it, in this economy, is enough for every Indian who is not vulnerable or in a state of vulnerability to be able to, from their own personal income, consume what they want across the life cycle by buying it from the market. And where, therefore, state intervention happens only by default to help someone who has temporarily fallen out of this. We are nowhere there, obviously. But that is the aspiration. That is why we want growth, that is why we want a larger economy. But this aspiration for a larger economy is a relatively new one, and this is very important. Let me ask any of the younger people here, we know Professor Deshpande, you know the answer, so please refrain. When do you think the first time poverty was mentioned as an object of Indian economic policy? 1969, after the Mahanobis Income Distribution Report. Poverty was never an objective of the Indian state from 1947 to 1969. Our objective was to build IITs, to build steel plants, to build Bhakra Nangal, that gentleman, Children's Day Karna hai, jiske budget, that he led this. And from 47 onwards, that was our objective. Why was it an objective? This is something that I've written about years ago with John Toy, because if you forget the history of India, India in 1947 was a recently colonized economy. Maybe we are still colonized in the mind, I don't know. But economically, certainly we were. So the big fear then was that we would become colonized again or we'd be a failed project. You know, we were really worried in those days about becoming like Pakistan has become today. Not to emulate them, but to become like them, worried about it. And the way not to do it, we thought, was to invest not in, and that is why this conundrum about having a big army, I'm going to give you my resolution for it in a minute, was not to actually protect yourself just from invaders, but also to learn from our history and produce the things at home that would enable us to protect ourselves from external threat. In French, it's called material de guerre, the materials of war. And those materials of war in those days were essentially heavy, if you read the second five-year plan, heavy industry, heavy chemicals. You'll find the word heavy used not in the rock star sense, but in the second five-year plan, I calculate my thesis, the word heavy was used 156 times across the plan. Everything was heavy. Heavy chemicals, heavy industry, heavy manufacturing. What they meant was capital goods, what my father used to call the machines to produce the machine. But the objective of doing that was not poverty reduction, was not growth maximization. It was to get the base of the economy such that if we had to fight wars, which we did, we were self-sufficient. The crux of this came, I don't know how many of you know this story, my father told me this, I was not even born. When India decided also to achieve self-sufficiency in food and to had an organized program to quit foreign aid. And this happened because in 1965, apparently, we are from Bombay, when US used to provide us a lot of our wheat. And when our war with Pakistan began, these US ships had come outside Bombay Harbour. My father saw it with his own eyes. They opened their ship holds and they dumped the wheat into the sea. And from that day on, there was a program to reduce our aid dependence, which went down dramatically by the end of the 70s to 3% of GDP, and now it is in second decimal points. Well, from the 90s, it has been in second decimal points. Don't confuse an IMF program with aid. This is actually transfers of, you know, stuff here. So self-reliance and self-sufficiency was the primary driver there. But in 1971 onwards, we began to worry about poverty. I'll come to that in a minute. But so what are the public finance implications? There were three public finance implications here. One was that essentially in the from the 50s to the 70s, governments would not worry about anything other than making capital investments. And therefore all borrowing and desirably some taxation would be for capital investment. All borrowing and some taxation. Second, the prime mover of this would be the government of India, not the state governments. By definition, because this had to be an all India project, it had to go in concert with other things such as faith equalization, such as dispersal of industry, such as setting up Hindustan Machine Tools. Yeah, I saw that lovely building, somebody should restore it. Such as Bangalore, developing from being a small cantonment town into a public sector hub. That was the genesis of this project. And then of course, after that, in the late 60s, we began the Green Revolution, which was also the prime mover of that, had to be central government, but that was more a partnered project. So what you saw in the public finances of India in those days were small state budgets, finance commissions giving over 80% of resources to the center, 70 or 80%, and the state governments basically doing law and order, police, managing community finances, etc. Now, when it came to the business of poverty reduction, I'm not yet come to other stuff, like health and education, just poverty reduction. Then it became apparent that this could not just be done through central fiat. So, but till that realization came, you began to see more and more and more money being spent by the central government on poverty reduction. I'm going to fast forward a bit from this. Come to the 90s, you begin to see a second change, which is the self-reliance project. Now, I can say this with the hindsight of history, so I'm not blaming anybody who wrote anything then. was deemed to be more or less complete, and if there was any incompleteness, it lay in lack of access to technology, markets, ways of doing things, and therefore we had what I call the great liberalization. Not of the Indian economy, it continues to be a rationed and regulated economy. Just look at the number of circulars that come out of the finance ministry or the RBI every day. God help me, this is a regulated economy. Number of things I have to sign every day. Regulated, low trust economy. But two things we did liberalize. Industrial licensing and trade liberalization. And therefore the expectation was that the private sector would do the heavy lifting in terms of generating economic growth. And therefore, both the central and state governments over time, and this culminated in sort of, you saw it in NDA, you saw it from 96, the dream budget onwards, in the rights-based approach, NREGA, you know, education, health. From the 80s to the early 2000s, what did this mean for Indian public finance? It meant two worrying things, that the increasing expectation that state governments would do more and more about poverty reduction, would do more and more as a consequence of wanting to reduce poverty, to reduce their expenditure, to increase their expenditures on broadly called human development, health, education, water supply, sanitation. And the growing demands of law and order meant that state government finances became increasingly partless and difficult to manage, and state government deficits began to go up very sharply. Karnataka has actually been an outlier in this. This is probably the best managed, I'm showing my biases, but this state has not had, compared to even Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, certainly Kerala, has not had the sorts of problems that most other states have had, continues, touch wood, not to yet. But so don't go by your own state, but broadly speaking, if you took Sigma states in India, they had a problem. And the government of India, from 1980-81 onwards, slowly and consistently since then, abandoned the fundamental proposition then of Nehruvian public policy on what government did, which is thou shalt borrow to build infrastructure. So this reification of capital expenditure comes from there, comes from that intent. Now I have to give you a bit of accounting. I have to, I guess, because the agenda is, bear with me. You can borrow, I'm going to be very careful in what I say, you can borrow to make investments. Now, all investments are not good. You can borrow, if I borrow and put money into Air India, that's also capital expenditure. Huh? By increasing Air India equity, or increasing equity in Vijaya Bank is also capital expenditure. Huh? Or you can do that famous thing, I'm sure Karnataka also does it, certainly my two states, Andhra and Maharashtra, do it. You can borrow for irrigation. And after 10 years, you can see not one increase in net sewn area, but you can borrow for irrigation. Also capital expenditure. I'm not talking about good or bad. Or you can borrow for what I will call for you, what economists call, let me put it this way, consumption expenditure, what I think fiscal administrators correctly call recurrent expenditure. And the proposition is that consumption or recurrent expenditure should be financed entirely out of taxes. You should not borrow, at least in the long term or medium term, for recurrent expenditure, consumption expenditure. And I tell you why this rule is important in a minute, but let me give you some numbers. So the state governments began increasing more and more their recurrent, or what we call revenue expenditure, and they began borrowing for it in substantial measure from 1980-81. But the central government also began to borrow for recurrent expenditure. I'm going to give you the numbers, they're very frightening. Remember, the state central government only gives money to the states to spend on health. They don't do any health except Kendriya Vidyalaya or AIIMS or something. IIT, no longer IIT, something new. But it's marginal, right? The action is the states when it comes to stuff like poverty. Okay. So if you take the total borrowing, and I say, what was the percentage of borrowing for recurrent expenditure as a percentage of total borrowing? Is everybody with me? The percentage of borrowing, total borrowing is 100, what percent was for recurrent expenditure, not for investment? Numbers are as follows. 80-81, Government of India, 4.5%. 1991, my memory is working, I forgot these numbers, 27%. 2002-2003, 58%. 2013, 72%. Then people ask me why I was disappointed this year's fiscal slippage. 2017, 59% came down. This year's fiscal slippage, revenue expenditure, back to 72%. What am I saying to you? I'm saying the, no. So just keep this fact, I'm going to come back. I'm saying for every 1 rupee the government of India borrows, it spends 72 rupees not on investment. We'll discuss the merits of what it borrows for in a minute, but not on investment. Let's be clear about that. So when we talk about, some people talk about, we need to increase public investment for counter-cyclical, we're getting into even more rubbish. The central government for 30 years has not been in the business of public investment. But you know what? For the last 10 years, the states have. And you know why? Because from 2002 onwards, thanks to the FRPM, the states of India, sigma, all states, I have my individual problems, but all states do not, even to this day, and I've seen all those alarmist articles, do not borrow for recurrent expenditure, do not borrow for consumption. In administrative terms, sigma revenue deficit of all states is zero. It's at a small surplus last year. This year will probably be zero. Okay. Karnataka still runs a revenue surplus, right? Marginal, I mean, unfortunately. But at one point they were running seats. Another matter that my state, Maharashtra, now which is in serious, really bad trouble, has wasted its revenue. So basically they were paying for all their recurrent expenditure with taxes and saving some money, then borrowing 3% and investing that. So states like Bihar, in the good old days 4 years ago, had 5%. Of GSDP to put in investment. The problem was where to invest. That's a different matter. But let's be clear about this. So the states were fine. But the central government, the government of India, for every 100 paise that it borrows, spends 72 paise on recurrent expenditure. So the first thing, let's get out of this counter-cyclical and all that, and I'm telling you why you need to worry about the fiscal deficit at the sector. It is not being used for public investment. The government of India has exited the business of public investment 20 years ago. They were going to tell. From then on, trivial number, less than 1% of GDP for 20 years now. States are 3% plus on average. So if you actually want to look for public investment, come here. Go to the states, they have the money. So let's first completely dispense with that. Now let's go to recurrent expenditure. Why has this recurrent expenditure gone up? Coming to that in a minute, so I've written about it. What I'm going to say is not controversial. It is scary, but. I've written about the public domain, so there's no reason for me not to repeat it here. But first, let me deal with this. Why am I saying recurrent expenditure should be financed from taxation? Notice I'm using the word recurrent expenditure. So this is where the economic classification comes in very useful. What are the elements of recurrent expenditure? First element is wages and salaries. Second element is operational expenditure. Gaadi ka petrol, working capital. Third element is interest on debt. Fourth element is subsidies. Fifth element is transfers. What are transfers? Mr. Shastri takes money from Mr. Seth and gives it to me. Government is not creating any value. It is just taking money from X and giving it to Y. It's a very important function of government. It's the second theorem of welfare economics in play. They're redistributing. Okay. These are the five elements. Why should these be tax financed? Transfers by definition should be tax financed. Because if I'm taking from X to give to Y, I should not borrow. Right? It's a bit like my saying that I have a relative who has fallen on hard times in Aurangabad. So what I'm going to do is go to the bank, borrow some money and give it to the poor fellow. No, I should give him the money from my income if I'm more fortunate than him or her, right? So transfers have to be tax financed, you get it? Okay. By definition, and subsidies are a form of transfer. So both subsidies and transfers, your current expenditure, tax finance. By definition, interest on debt should be tax financed. This is household economics. If you borrow to pay your interest, you will have more interest to pay. Happening with the government of India, happening in large measure. 28% of revenue expenditure is now interest on debt. Wages and salaries. Yahan pe I have that I have my cousins here who are board teachers. So I'm going to take their example. If you don't mind, Prasadananda. So teachers are wonderful people, right? Nobody say no. Teachers and army don't touch. So why are they wonderful? Because they produce students. These students allegedly produce, not allegedly, chalo, give me, I'm an economist. Let's make a heroic assumption that they produce their human capital, like Roman, and they produce outputs throughout their life. No? Doctors also do that. If I train a doctor, that doctor is going to be in service. So it's like a capital good. So why am I booking a teacher's salary under revenue expenditure? I'll tell you why. Let's take Prasad. Prasad, when does your academic year end, Prasad?
May.
So in May, Prasad will have produced a cohort of wonderful students who till 2040 are going to provide increased GDP to the country. No? Agreed? Let's sack him in May. Exactly. Cool. I'll sack all my teachers in me. You look at me like I'm mad. You would be mad. I would be mad. Arey Baba, why do you not be sacking me? He's already produced those. Because you want more. Huh? And you want more. And you want more in perpetuity. You want him to keep producing these cohorts of students who produce output till the end of their lives in perpetuity. That is why this term consumption is misleading. It is recurrent expenditure. It is expenditure that you have to recur year after year. And you should know this from your household budget. If there's expenditure you must recur year after year after year on something, you must finance it from your income, not from your borrowing. And the only income a government has is revenue. So revenues must finance recurrent. It is not whether that expenditure produces lifetime returns, whether it is good expenditure, whether it is bad expenditure. The public finance guy can tell you. You want to make it capital expenditure? Fine, I'll do what we all do. I'll create a corpus. That's capital expenditure, and the interest from that corpus will pay his salary. So I can do engineering. But the principle of recurrent expenditure is very, very important. The fact, therefore, that you pay for teachers and you pay for consumables and you pay for all this is not a reason to borrow to consume in perpetuity and to an increasing level as the government of India has been doing. So the fact that the government of India transfers money on SSA, NRHM and all these things to pay for these salaries is no excuse for the government of India to borrow. The failure to tax at a level, and I'll come to that towards the end, is of course an issue here, and I'll come to that, because you have to think about that. It's not as simple as we don't tax enough. But I hope I've made my point. You can contest it later in the discussion. You cannot borrow even to pay teachers and doctors' salaries, because it is recurrent in nature, not because of what they do. I repeat, it is recurrent in nature. Government of India borrowing has gone up from, and the good news here is the states are somehow managing. The states are paying their teachers' salaries. I can tell you the states do some terrible thing. Karnataka does some wonderful things. I don't know how they manage to delay their pay commissions in such a simple way and stagger them. It's wonderful. Mamata Banerjee in West Bengal solved the problem by not paying DA. That's a huge political thing to do. That to in West Bengal, my God. They did not pay DA. They actually held up their DA installments. You will see that states, when they bite the bullet, they really bite it. It's not like Government of India. There are reasons for that. Government of India finances are difficult to manage. I'll tell you why in a minute. So, then we have to ask, okay, so why is this revenue deficit going up so much? The short answer to that is, when I was in the Pay Commission, I'll say this anecdote since you mentioned the Pay Commission, sir. I was, you know, I have a very low opinion of government. I'm a real right-wing fellow. So, all these, you know, you go to a government office, people are hanging around. You, what we call the low status, high power syndrome, it irritates people. And you know, your personal biases come. You're sitting there, you know, you get tortured at the airport, you get tortured at the bus stand. Basically, they're impediments to your life. Morning to night, morning to night, morning to night. So, I said, okay, now all these shiftless bureaucrats, I have a final chance. We should nationalize government and pay them more also. Went to look for these bureaucrats. Couldn't find any bureaucrats in the central government. I found that 40% of them work for the railways now. You may say that they may be, they're railway people, Baba. They're not bureaucrats, right? LHP railway people, they're linesmen and signal wala. They don't know what they do, but second is the armed forces. Very big. Very, very big. India, for good reason, needs both capital expenditure and expenditure on manpower because of our borders and its nature. And the armed forces bill is pretty high. It's like everyone is in Siachen, you see. Anyway, so we pay a lot of money to the armed forces. And that is not politically sort of, nobody would agree with, everybody would agree with, we must pay our soldiers more. Right? But we must pay them. And we need more soldiers, especially now. So armed forces is out. Let's not go there. Then we have a third item, which is the interest on debt. I can do nothing about it. Because that is, if you're going to borrow more and more for consumption, then your interest on debt is going to go up and up and up. So that 28% that's stuck. If interest rates come down someday, it may go down at the margin, but unlikely to make a big impact. Then what we have is a 300... Okay. Now the bureaucrats, please don't answer my question. You may know. I'm sure you know. There is only one department of the government of India which has seen an increase in both its manpower and its salary bill that I discovered in the Pay Commission over the last 30 years. Only one. Can you guess? Huh? Which one? No, I wish. Ministry of Home Affairs. Why has the bill gone? Why has the bill gone up? At the margin, as economists know, it's very important. The size of our paramilitary in 1988, this is just the middle of the Punjab government, it's not over, 300,000. Today, it is 1.1 million. 1.1 million. We've had a 300% increase in our paramilitary. And I was told during the FRBM, which I was a member of, by the then Home Secretary, now our CAG, that he does not expect this number to decline, rather increase over time. So at the margin, what has happened, I'm not going to go into, I'm not that foolish, go into the reasons for why our paramilitary has gone up. Okay. It has gone up as an empirically recorded fact, nobody can dispute it. Now the consequence, therefore, is that essentially what the government of India has been spending on, other than railways, which is highly constrained, is the armed forces and the paramilitary. If you actually look at the civil service, qua the civil service of the central government, it is tiny. It is nothing. I mean, we have no civil servants in this country. Whether you like them or don't like them, my prejudices apart. If you just take a cold empirical look at it, we are underserved by our civil servants. We are far too few. We are far too few. It is exactly quite frightening how, in fact, our diplomatic service, God knows how they manage. But it is quite a crisis in terms of the lack of manpower there. So it is the railways, it is the paramilitary and the military, which means that what the government of India has been increasingly doing over time, if you like, is running the basic functions of the state. And then transferring money to the state governments when it can, through NRHM, etc., to do more. Because the state governments have been reasonably solvent, and because GDP itself has drifted in the last 15 years, we've had broadly enough money to square this circle. But whenever there's a fiscal crisis, this circle does not get squared. And that is why we need to worry about the fiscal deficit. So to summarize, if you want to see the governments of India engage in growth, that's one set of expenditure, right? And you say that the private sector is not able to do its job, and you want the governments of India to engage in the business of human development, which is health and education and water supply and sanitation and Swachh Bharat, whether by financing it or by actually providing it, I'm not getting into that, then I'm afraid you will need a much higher tax GDP ratio than you have now to provide all these with current levels of efficiency. So the problem is not one of a Keynesian nature at all, which is why the Keynesians should be worried about the fiscal deficit, because the origin of this fiscal deficit, particularly in the case of the central government, have nothing to do with counter-cyclicality or otherwise. It has to do with the demands placed upon the state and its ability to meet these demands given the taxes that it is able to collect. So let's collect more taxes, everyone says. It's come to that time of the evening where I'm going to make my last point. Shall we collect more taxes? You decide. You all, how many of you, most of you are citizens, I mean, don't work in government, right? So you're net taxpayers, not like me, not like you, not like you. The salary comes from the government. Okay. The state plus the center, the governments of India, what we call general government, tax GDP ratio is about 17%. Fiscal deficit of the center is about 3.5%. States combined is about 3.2 now. So that's about 6.7. So between 6.5% and 7% we borrow, and 17% we tax. That is 24% of your GDP. 24% of your GDP, almost 1 rupee in 4, is being utilized by the government, not the public sector, general government, center plus states, for whatever they do. You want a larger government in these terms? Up to you. I'm not saying you shouldn't. You want a larger government? What do you want? 30% of... No transfers here. This is not like the welfare state in Europe. Transfer the very small proportion of this where he takes money from Ajay and gives it to me. Most of this is being used at current levels of productivity, at current levels of efficiency, to produce goods and services for your energy. Okay, and this is systemic now. There are no individuals involved because at this level of GDP, you can't talk about, that chap is bad. No, all that Palmara talk goes on. Systemically, 24% of GDP is being used to deliver you the goods and services you're getting now. You want more in the hands of this 24%. Because that brings you to Keynes. Ha ha. That brings you to Keynes. This is the final deal in memory. That brings you to Keynes. Because remember what I said at the beginning. Levels of output and activity can be expanded by expanding the size of government in a balanced budget way. If you believe that the most effective way to increase levels of output and activity and growth in this country is to expand the size of the state, then you're okay. And then your argument is consistent with the larger state. So if you're a communist, I have complete sympathy with you. Because you will say that state-led capitalism, if you like, is the most efficient way to increase growth and output. But if you're not a communist, if you're a social democrat like I am, politics is important here. This is where our normative biases come in, and therefore our theories. Then you will begin to wonder whether 1 rupee in 4 is not large enough for the delivery of public goods and services through taxation plus borrowing. And if, like me, you believe that 1 rupee in 4 is enough and we must be able to provide, and remember, this 1 rupee in 4 is growing, huh? GDP is growing every year in real terms by 6-7%. So every year in real terms, this pie is growing by 6-7%. So I'm not constricting it. I'm talking about share. 25 paise in the rupee is spent by the governments of India. I don't believe that this number can be exceeded. I think it's very difficult to lower it. I don't think it ought to be. I think 1 in 4 is quite enough without large-scale welfare state type transfers. Then, boss, if you're going to tell me that I want more taxes because I want to spend more on education, no, sir. Because if you agree with me that 25 is enough, I will use that money to reduce debt. I will not use that money to increase spending on education. It's a hard arithmetic. So when you argue for more increases in education, and if you agree with me, it should not be borrowed but tax financed, I've taken you down that journey, and you want more taxes, then in effect, you are arguing, please remember, for a larger state at its current levels of efficiency, output and delivery. And if you do not want that, then you will necessarily have to manage within this money to increase the productivity of the system, which is what finance departments keep telling people and they get irritated. But that is really what they're telling you. They may tell you in bureaucratic language or otherwise that this is a lot of money you're spending. For God's sake, consider whether you want to spend it more productively or you want yet more. Okay. And as a Keynesian, I should be worried for this reason and ultimately for one more reason to do with borrowing, with which I should close and then conclude. We have a very unique problem in India. It's actually very uniquely Indian. The Indian economy is unique, is not really very true. I've worked in many and it's reasonably non-unique. Some unique features. Sociology is unique. That's a different matter. Therefore, the impact of economic policy is unique, but not the economy. There is one unique aspect of the Indian economy, which is very worrying. So, let me give you this simple algebra. Now, this is going back to Keynes. Investment GDP ratio of India is 2016 numbers, but 30% of GDP. So, 30% of GDP by investing. How do you finance it? It must come from saving, right? It's simple, arithmetic. It can either come from my saving or foreigners invest in my country. Foreigners investing in my country is equal to FDI plus FII, 4% of GDP. So it must be arithmetically true that 26% of my investment is financed through domestic saving. Correct? Arithmetically true. Got it? Everybody got it? 30 is total investment, 4 is financed by foreigners, therefore 26 must be financed by. But when I look on the saving side, this year is a little better. I look at savings from chit funds, finance, non-banking finance, everywhere I can get data, that number comes to 11.5. Oh. 12. So the remaining 26, no, not borrowing. I don't know where the saving is. I know where it is. So every time I take some money, I don't want to get into like demonetization and all that informal sector, but analytically, every time I take some money and I give it directly to a builder to build a house, it is not counted directly as financial saving. Because it doesn't enter a bank, got it? Or NIC or internally. So a large proportion of our savings actually does not enter the financial system. This is why this Jandhan is so important. And this financial inclusion from a macroeconomic perspective. I need guys to be putting money in the financial system. Why? Because the governments of India, the Indian public sector, and the Indian private corporate sector cannot borrow other than from that 12%. They cannot. There is no way they can access that remaining 26 minus 12. Whatever you get in a bank, LIC, etc., that's all they can borrow from. Now look at our fiscal deficit from that Keynesian perspective. 12% financial saving, 7% taken away by government, 1.5% taken away by the public sector, leaves you with 3.5% for the private corporate sector. You want to make them the engine of growth. They're good or bad, we can discuss. But assuming you want to make them the engine of growth, what are they going to do with 3.5? Then you have that 4% FDI, which we are using. So they get 7, 7.5, that's how we have been managing. But you realize that we can't really afford, on this Keynesian count of increasing output, employment and activity, to allow for fiscal deficits to go up. So this is the other macroeconomic reason why Keynesians should worry about the fiscal deficit. So to conclude, this has been a movie in many parts. I began by telling you why theory is important. I tried to then show you, or sort of collect for the older people in this audience, what a Keynesian was, and what a Keynesian is, and how that term has been vulgarized by economists now, by conflating it with terms like counter-cyclical and output gap, and how, if you think analytically, you will understand that it is in the sense of increasing public spending to deal with the Keynesian problem, which is to increase aggregate demand, borrowing is the second best. I then moved into Indian public finance and tried to tell you that the Keynesian conundrum was never our conundrum. And you may say it was bad. I mean, Prabhat Patnaik has written a lot saying the problem in India was one of underconsumption in the 70s, 80s, etc. I know economists have written that. The point is making is it was never the government policy objective till the 80s to spend money on poverty reduction or on demand creation. And in the 90s, we decided that growth would be something the private sector did, and the government therefore started moving into human development. I then showed you at a sort of subfederal level what that meant, and the very serious fiscal deficit problem we have with the central government, where 70% of the money is actually used for recurrent expenditure. And then I showed you, including with teacher salaries, why it is not a good idea, why you cannot in perpetuity borrow to pay for recurrent expenditure, which you are now. And then I also showed you other constraints on central government spending that mean that we are fiscally constrained, and therefore we do need to worry about the fiscal deficit, both because, as you were saying, so of its composition and because of its magnitude. And then finally, I came back to the macroeconomic question, which is you get growth through investment. Investment requires savings. We know how much foreign savings are coming in. It's not going to go up more than 4%. And therefore, we need to make sure that there is enough saving to generate private investment at affordable prices for finance. But when you look at the peculiarly Indian conundrum of financial saving being less than half of total saving, then actually the available pool of investment finance in India is much lower than our investment savings numbers would suggest. And that, in addition, poses the constraint on the fiscal deficit, which is a very Keynesian one. Thank you.
Thank you, Rathin. Thank you for an excellent lecture, and I'm sure Ajay will agree with me. He's also worked in finance department for many years. I mean, whatever you said is absolutely, we are completely in sync with you and your views on this. For any guy in finance, this whole issue of fiscal deficit and revenue surplus are really important issues, and I completely agree with you on just what everything you have said and how we need to cap our revenue expenditure and size of the government. And that's one of the biggest problems in government financing is the salaries and wages. And I don't know whether we can continue like this even with existing growth rates and existing levels of employment, even on adding more people. In the coming years, we may find it even difficult to continue to pay like this, or we'll have to, I mean, it'll be cannibalizing on some other important item of expenditure. Thank you very much, Rathin, and also thank you for summarizing your own talk in the end very crisply. So I'll request Mr. Roy to take some questions now. The house is open.
Is mic going on?
Yeah, no, there is another mic.
Yeah, somebody there wants to ask a question.
Thank you for the wonderful lecture, Dr. Roy. I'm Anupam from the Tatishila Institution. So just a quick question on the first bit on the theoretical model. Is Friedman's Nairu some sort of approximation of your potential output, or does that not Does it give a theoretical underpinning for potential output and then thus the output gap and so on, or does it not count at all? It's one question, and I know the audience groans when I say it. I have a second question as well, but let me just take the liberty very quickly to say that in terms of bringing about market discipline, right, FRBMA has almost failed and we've missed the targets over and over again since 2003. What if we just, you know, completely bring down SLR rates to zero, and then, you know, will that force governments to borrow from the market? Will that bring about a bit of market discipline?
Okay, on DIMO, actually, I should correct you epistemically. DIMO is actually not Friedman. It's Liard and Nickel.
Yeah, okay.
And, well, the natural inflation accelerated rate of unemployment involves a relationship between inflation and employment, which is exactly what output gap theory does not do when it defines potential output. Because potential output is defined without reference to inflation, you see. And then in output gap modeling, you derive the inflation that arises as a consequence of the output gap. So again, yet again, this is the problem with having too much data, because it's very easy to rush into a state model to do output gap. And that's what people do. Okay, so that's your first question. On your second question, no, because now banks are holding more than SLR. So if banks are holding more than SLR, then, and I want to disagree with you a bit, I do not think FRBM 1 failed. In the case of the state governments, emphatically did not fail. It was a remarkable success, and I can tell you, at the political level, having spoken to a few chief ministers, this I use for GST also, sir, not with your CM, some other CMs. You know, one transition you have to make in your mind, we are not making this, we are still third world in our skull, in a number of ways. But one transition you have to make in your mind when you become a middle-income country, and then like our state governments, you have money, is that when you want to give favors, when you want to favor Bellary over Mangalore, you do it through the expenditure side. You don't do it through the tax side. So I told them that I said, sir, GST, you will get money, and then you'll have more money on the expenditure side, then you can play your political games. Right? So in the same way with FRBM, what states have realized, most states, even the states that are defaulting have realized. And that is why the first thing Mamata Banerjee did, you know, West Bengal is a very curious paradox. It is the longest ruled communist state in the country that had the lowest tax on capitalists of any state in the country. They didn't tax capitalists. Their own tax equity ratio was the lowest in the country for years. She raised OTR and she curbed expenditure. Why? Because it gives you autonomy from the center, and that autonomy allows you to take your own decisions. Otherwise, you get tied into centrally sponsored schemes, etc. And your ability to run what has been very patronizingly called populist schemes is reduced. And you want to run populist schemes, you want to come to power, and you want to do it in a fiscally responsible way. So the FRBM is now, I think, self-disciplinary, so I don't know if you like it. It is not because the central government will not give you money that states are doing in FRBM. They're doing it because it enables them to maintain their fiscal autonomy, and that is done extremely effectively. With the central government, I'll say this much. The FRBM has certainly focused the minds of the Ministry of Finance and the finance minister on at least reducing the aggregate fiscal deficit number or keeping it within FRBM levels. On the revenue deficit, I'm afraid that many of the things I have told you have not been understood, and there has been a kind of, I can only put this, a collapse of will on the part of the central government, where the very concept of the revenue deficit is sought to be abandoned in the next FRBM, despite the fact that our committee had in fact recommended a roadmap. And that, I think, is an undesirable phenomenon, but nevertheless, the principle of FRBM does act as a restraint on the government of India. Now, the only alternative to that in the long term, we know from painful experience at the national level, is an International Monetary Fund program. And I'd rather have an FRBM than an IMF program any day.
Actually, he was waiting, if you don't mind, okay, he says you can take.
Rathin, two questions. One was, you mentioned about the fiscal deficit slippage from 3.2% to 3.6%. When you see where the composition of where the government is spending that money, roughly more than half of it is going into the armed forces. This year's 3.6 trillion rupees of the 6.1 trillion fiscal deficit is actually capex. Another 1 trillion is going to rural development. 1.5 is food subsidy, and about 300 to 400 billion is fuel subsidy. So I'm not sure, when you talked about revenue going in for non-capex, I don't know how you reconcile that. That's number one. And I think this government has done far better on fiscal management than the previous ones. Second question is, when you're talking of a transformational change, incremental 6, 7, 7.5, TK, when you're talking of a per capita income moving from $2,000 to $8,000 or $10,000, and when your private capital expenditure has completely flattened out and may or may not pick up in the coming years for many of the reasons you mentioned, what is the other option except for the regular Keynesian kind of economics along with the fiscal deficit going up with it to achieve that kind of per capita income growth?
Again, I disagree with you on the numbers. See, this is why you should not do them in percentages of GDP. Fact, the program, the revenue deficit, which measures your borrowing for consumption as a proportion of your fiscal deficit, was to have declined to 59.1% if we had stayed at 3.2. When we went to 3.5, if it had been at 59.1, it would be correct. It has gone up to 73. So our incremental borrowing is for consumption, is for revenue expenditure. Fact. The armed forces expenditure is not capex by frame. It is defense pensions. I've done this analysis, it's in my article in the Business Times. Number one, defense pensions. Number two, GST compensation. In fact, I'm sympathetic to answer your second part. When I commented after the budget, I said that I'm particularly troubled by this fiscal deficit because it has happened because of factors that are entirely outside the control of the Ministry of Finance. And that really worries me. If the Finance Ministry had done populist expenditure, fine. You know, that's 1 year. It is not populist. It is a failure of non-tax revenue, which means our line ministries are not cooperating. They are not cooperating. The RBI is not cooperating. Our armed forces expenditure is going out. No, or not, you will pay the consequences. And the GST thing, the states, we have come up with a very soft deal. This 14% growth, I mean, as Finance Secretary must be thrilled. You're guaranteed compensation if your tax preparation doesn't go up by 14%. Nice, but somebody has to pay the price. So on that, I agree. On fiscal management, you know, I would say that I was quite impressed the last 4 years by the restraint this government has shown. I know it's not popular. I don't care what, see, I'm a fiscal guy. You can say that I'm going to transform agriculture. I just look at the money. So when you say I'm going to change the face of healthcare in India, if I see 4,000 crores or 10,000 crores in the budget, I know this is for technical work, and I know that the real expenditure will be taken on the basis of a considered decision, right or wrong, I feel relieved. So this government has not been populist. It has never been populist. It is perhaps the least obvious. There were many things they could have done to be populist. Huh? They could have tripled expenditure in NREGA. You know, they could have put 100 rupees in everyone's Jan Dhan account. I was terrified this would happen, because some of the rhetoric was like that. And their expectations. It did not do that. It did not do that. And it cut its cloth according to its quote, and therefore the slippage in the fiscal deficit, again, has nothing to do with the Finance Ministry's ability to control the fiscal. It has to do with far more serious matters. In terms of raising the fiscal deficit, see, my answer is this, that if you believe as I do that ultimately it is going to be that GDP growth in India is going to happen because of the private sector, I'm going to take advantage of this question, if I may, sir, to go into something. Then we have to examine why the private sector is not investing. My theory of why the private sector is not investing is this. It's going to take me a minute. And it's a teaser. It will take a full lecture to tell you. I think India's growth from 1991 has not been export led. When we have had good export growth, we have had high growth. That's a correlation. It's not been export led. It's been domestic demand. What domestic demand? I tell you who's domestic demand. When I was teaching you, Shivatsa, in 1988 in Sri Ram College of Commerce, tabhi pay commission gaya tha, pay commission had come, my salary was 3,000 rupees a month. Maruti car was 1.5 lakhs. 3.8 years salary. Air conditioner, those days, 25,000. You do the math, 9 months salary. Today, same guy, entry level pay commission, SD, 60,000 rupees a month. Right? Maruti car, 8 months salary. Air conditioner, 3 days salary. There has been a massive movement in relative prices in favor of the middle class and above, that is people earning 7x and above the minimum wage. That was our growth impulse, that is over. We are now coming into what we call asymptotes. We are approaching a middle income gap. So unless we start producing what people between x and 3x the minimum wage can consume, we will be in trouble. There are three private sector things there, and two public sector things that all Indians consume, not Ishwar, all Indians. Food, balanced diet, clothing, housing, health, education. If 70% of our growth comes from this, then we will be fine. But this will have to be essentially private sector led. So the solution is not going to be, again, an increase in borrowing to finance public expenditure without changing the structure of our economy to get those growth rates that are sustainable. And I'll say one thing to you, nobody understands this better than the Prime Minister.
Hi, I'm a bit of an outsider. side of it, because I'm not an economist, but one thing that I observe is definitely the problem with salaries and salary pays, salary bills not being paid at the state government level. When I work in the urban modeling, I actually look at those numbers, and that is obvious. But my question was on essentially, you're saying for the role of the state, if you can say that the role of the state is supposed to take care of its wards, then how do you go about financing the public programs? So how do you raise the finance for that? For example, I think the central government is also talking about universal basic income as one of the programs they want to start doing. How would you go about raising that money?
See, this is a very important thing. I'm glad you asked that question. It will help me refocus. See, we must get out of this. You know, public finance is not raising a subscription fund for a club. It is our own money, and we have to decide whether we use that money through the public purse or we use the money for our own consumption and investment. So that's a political decision. I have told you what the facts are today. You have 17 paise in the rupee being raised by taxation, and you have 7 paise in the rupee being raised by borrowing. So the governments of India are already spending 1 rupee out of every 4 rupees of GDP. You want to increase it, I have no problem. But you will only be able to increase it by either saving less or consuming less. If I tax you more, you will save and consume less. If I borrow more from you, you will have less of your own savings to invest. I'm talking about you as the private sector firms plus housing. That's Keynesian. Now, if you think that's a better idea, and these are not temporary things, these are one-way streets. Once I start, as you can see with this monster of SSA, all these centrally sponsored schemes, once you start them, you can only let them die through withering. Every finance professional knows that, right? You can let a program in the government of India or in the state government wither away. You cannot shut it. Oh, if you could shut it, we'd be in such different. But in our complex sociology, in our complex society, the moment you take a program to scale, why do 90% of our programs fail? Because you create stakeholders, not in the program's beneficiaries, but in the rents that can be got from running those programs, and those stakeholders will prevent you from shutting the program with the best will in the world. Therefore, you can't do these smart textbook things like, oh, let's raise education spending for 5 years. Anyway, the very statement is meaningless. So the other question I would ask you is that if you want to increase government spending on a permanent basis, if you want, right, then are you willing to accept a larger state? That is, you want to increase it by more than 11% in nominal terms, 7% real plus 4% inflation, that you're getting anyway at constant GDP levels. On a permanent basis, then the share of government in GDP is going to go up. Do you want that? You decide. If the share of GDP, government in GDP goes up, your share in GDP goes down. There is no free lunch share. So it is not a club subscription. That's why actually it is like a club subscription. So are you willing to give more money to the Basmati club you go to bigger? Is that the club? To improve their sort of surrounding and environments, which means you spend less money at home. You know, your family might have something to say about that. So that's a political decision you all have to take, and that depends on ideology. I for one don't believe we should. I believe that we will have to do what we can with our money, growing at a reasonable 11% a year. And what I've tried to tell you is that increasingly that focus on how we can do it, I hope the Finance Commission understands this, is going to have to be on the states. The center is not now a fit instrument for working on human development.
You mentioned that financial savings account for about 11-12%, you know. What kind of a trend do you see for the next 5-10 years? Because you said out of 26, only 11-12% represents financial savings, and they are the ones available for private corporate sector. With the growing financialization that we are seeing in recent months or in the last year or two, don't you expect that number to go up significantly in the next 5 years?
You have caught me at a weak point. I now feel like an oncologist or a neurologist. You see, you will agree with me that financialization of the Indian economy has gone up since 1991. The ratio of financial savings to total savings has gone down. It used to be 14, it went down to 9. Only now it's ticking up. So I would like to say that it will go up. But my recent history tells me that I simply don't know what the hell is going on in that body.
all I've examined this since I've come back in great detail. I've looked for analytical work on physical savings and financial savings. We don't know, the RBI doesn't know, the working group on savings doesn't know. We have only what I call parvara information. Oh, Indian culture, we are putting money in gold. Oh, Indian culture, we are putting money in chit fund. It's all anecdotal. There's been no systematic study that is able to explain, because when it's physical saving, then it's very difficult to distinguish between physical saving and physical and consumption. So the number we are getting is just residue, because it's an arithmetic identity, right? That 26% must be domestic. I know 12 is financial, therefore I infer that the residual must be physical, but I can't find the physical. But if I knew what the physical was, then I could. So then you get these ill-gotten policies, like gold pay, they're obsessed by gold. Then you do something. Hope is that with Jandhan accounts and all that, things will happen. But then, who am I to say something? That's why I said I'm like an oncologist who's asking me today when we have a cash crisis. So what can I say?
I was wondering to what extent the cost of borrowing correlates with the proportion of non-capex expenditure that you're talking about. In other words, I was wondering, is the government penalized if it is not fiscally prudent? That is question number one. Quick question number two is that the kind of tariff war that Trump has kicked off, and considering the trade imbalance in favor of India to the extent of about $25 billion, so what options does India have if Trump insists on tariffs on our goods? And what will be its knock-on effect on our economy and hence the fiscal deficit? Thank you.
Trump's tariffs will impact China more than India. So except in the IT sector, I'm afraid, and some financial services, and possibly some pharma, I don't see a major impact. I'm far more worried about the tapering than I'm worried about the potential trade war that Trump will unleash, because I think the impact of those tariffs should be asymmetrically higher on China. That's a real concern. Some industries will suffer, the macro level, no. On the first question, this is very interesting, and I'm sure that my colleagues from finance here, Karnataka government, must find this very irritating. But it is a feature of the Indian economy that the interest rate, the optioned interest rate on state development loans and central loans, despite central finances being worse off than state finances, states pay more than the sector. It should not be the case. And two, a fiscally prudent state like Karnataka gets exactly the same interest rate as a completely imprudent state like Punjab, because the market treats it all as sovereign. So better fiscal policy is not rewarded with lower interest rates. Now, again, in India, because we are such a socialist country in our skulls, I'm a social democrat, not a socialist, you know, we try and say engineering can engage me. You know, we love to do this. So now there are huge government commitments. How do we force the markets to recognize? You don't do that. The market is like, how do we create employment? You know, I find this such a stupid question. You can't create employment. Employment happens when activity happens. If you want to create employment, we'll do it in the time on it. We'll employ our friends and relatives in the public sector. That's the only way you can create employment as government. So in the same way, there is this great frustration that is happening, that we don't have a market that is mature enough to deal with levels of sovereignty. Two solutions to this would be, one, open it up to foreigners. I don't like that, because I don't like government paper being in the hands of foreigners, because I've lived long enough abroad and I've seen enough countries to know exactly what those foreigners do when you have a crisis. Second is to develop our bond markets. They're very interested in that. So if we develop broader bond markets, and if we are able to finance more long-term investment broadly out of fixed income, then that maturity will, I think, allow for a better calibration of public debt. But when the public debt is the only game in town, and the investors are also in the public sector, and the manager of that public debt is also the RBI, you basically have a fixed game here in favor of the central government, which I don't think they desire.
I don't think you know that I am not a public finance person, I am an agriculture economist, and I am absolutely naive. Finally, you said about culture. I find that this culture of budget and budget presentation, especially the figures, GDP, percent to GDP, fiscal deficit as percent to GDP, this as percent to GDP, the GDP real figures, the actual figures arrive 3 years later, and we give the percent to GDP this year. Either this is masking, and the culture of the budget, when I say, sometime we presented the budget in the evening so that it can be seen in England, then it was brought to 11 o'clock, and still we have to get out of the black and red briefcase. No budget, even in the communist state, is presented in a black briefcase. It has to be red briefcase, something which is standard and written in government orders. I don't know. But then, the culture of budget
if we are spending, if we are committing deficit out of the revenue, it should be percent to the revenue earned, not to the GDP or GSDP. Because these are the figures which are going to be later on, and by that we are masking the people's eyes that you don't really get the number which is actual number, and that comes a little later, and that's where the fiscal targeting comes in. Second thing I always try to, and you may be able to answer this perfectly, I try to get into this 3% embargo. Where did this number 3 came from? Why it is not 2.9, why it is not 2.8, why it is not 3.7, why it is not 3.2? This 3 is something which is troubling me, and I try to reason it out with a lot of things, including the FRBM Act, reading it out. I did not find anything, and I find again there is a culture of budget that yes, we have to be there. And why should we be there? We do not know. So these two questions.
The first question, I'm in complete sympathy with you. I think, I don't know what to do about this, because many years ago, Vijay Kirkar and people wrote this thing about reforming the Ministry of Finance. Where do I begin? We are so caught up in business process of the colonial period in the way we conduct our financial business that we are suffering from this. I don't know where to begin. It's not just a matter of boxes in the budget calendar. It is mildly rude phrase, this sort of pointless interruptus budgeting. We don't have the space at this time to undertake medium-term budgeting. And therefore, it hampers finance departments in making what I call non-munim arguments to line departments when they want to control expenditure. So if I were able to give my finance departments the power to have 3-year rolling expenditure frameworks, and then the budget presentation would actually be talking about what went wrong this year and what we hope to do 3 years from now, correcting for this year. That would hugely empower and improve the quality of budgeting in India. This box and this annual budgeting is a horrible thing. We are a third world country, not just a colonial country, in many ways that has gone down. But let me tell you that as late as 2008, the finance minister of India thought that it was okay, that time Chidambaram, to get up in parliament and talk about giving some tax relief on women's lipstick. You know, all this you do when you're a bachcha, when you don't have any serious work in a finance ministry. So 85, 88, what finance ministry, trivial economy, lipstick, pan masala, this is the conversation we used to have. What were we then? Nothing. Now we are a $3 trillion economy. Boss, your budget is $1 trillion. Get clear. You know, that we have done to some extent. And this government, I must say, when it presented its tax reform proposals 2 years ago, it's gone back to that now, in the middle it's there. It presented 6 tax reforms, and then all its tax policy proposals came. This tax reform, therefore this tax proposal. That's good. But on the other side, which is the economic side, and it is really hampering finance administrators, I asked somebody once, I said, you know the difference between, this is on the revenue side, huh? Expenditure, I told you what the problem is. An estimate, a projection, and a forecast, they're 3 different words in the English language. Estimate, projection, forecast. What does a tax department do? Not because they want to. They do estimates based on targets, and those targets, and meeting them or not, gives you projections. Have you seen the film Lagan? We are still doing that. We don't have forecasts. What is our tax base? Income tax. What is the base? Income. So for a given structure of tax rates, how should income taxes go up? When incomes go up, so for every rise in income, you should know by how much income taxes go up. That's called buoyancy. You can't do it in 1 year. You should do it in a multi-period. Do we do that? No. What do? We give targets to our income tax officer, ki jaake collect karo. Go and collect. So your Bangalore guy will come and harass him. They will overcharge. They will undercharge. It's a terrible way to do tax policy because it's no different from the permanent settlement. We do lagan. Why do we? And therefore we have estimates. We have projections. You will never see from any finance ministry a tax policy forecast. Same thing is true of state level taxes. Why don't we pay attention to this? Especially because it is very convenient in a society where discretion and not rules govern the administration of taxes, which is why I'm such a strong supporter of GST.
when discretion and not rules govern, then basically there are ends to be made from having lagan type taxation. So coming to forecast will not help you, because forecast, you're accountable to the forecast, no? If you go wrong, you have to explain why you went wrong. We don't have that accountability. Luckily, things like GST are bringing it, but we will need to bring in that culture of medium-term budgeting and medium-term taxation. Otherwise, too many things are outside the control of the finance ministry today to expect it to do its job as custodian of fiscal resources. And one of the things that they need is this medium-term framework and this empowerment to work on forecast and impose accountability both in expenditure and in revenue based on forecast, not in terms of how much money you spend, not spend, surrender, all these colonial terms.
Then, why the 3%?
Oh, why the,
and also, should it not be a function of the revenue collection rather than
a
percentage of GDP?
Revenue collection, it should be a function of, meaning you know my tax-GDP ratio. It's, okay, if I know my total taxation and I know my total expenditure, I know the difference between my taxation and expenditure is total borrowing. Right? So suppose I tell you my total borrowing is 200,000 crores in India. What does it mean? Nothing, because it could be 300,000 crores, it could be 400,000 crores. So borrowing, even if we look at the household level, we look at it in relation to the total income of the household, and the total income of the country is GDP. Therefore, it is divided by GDP. And in a growing economy, therefore, it tells you also the fiscal space you have as a result of growth.
You and me, we know very well how dependable figures GDP are, how are they arrived at. And most of the economists here would know that the problem of, something is notional and it can change. The moment you change the livestock assumption, everything changes. The moment you change the agriculture assumption, everything changes. This is, I would call it as a notional figure. Let the general public believe that it is income of the country. Let them believe. As an economist, I would say that it is a notional figure in order to have something in mind. But then, the revenue figure, what is estimated, forecasted, is the real figure in hand, and why it is not used. This culture has set in so much that I think Prasad sir would tell that there must be a clerk who is put to search for Basavanna's vachanas or somebody's vachanas in order to put in the budget, or a shire in Delhi to bring out a proper shayari. The culture is, unless there is a shayari, unless there is a vachana in the budget, is not complete. This kind of cultural dogmas are not otherwise. They are in economics too. The economics of budget itself carries the cultural dogmas. How do we deal with it?
Well, I think the GDP thing, I would say, is a bit like democracy. I mean, if you have a better number, we need some income number. I know that GDP in India is underestimated, and it's a bit like financial saving. I can only borrow from the income I see. I know it's underestimated, which is great. So, but I cannot borrow as government or as private corporate sector, the two sectors that matter for GDP, from the income I cannot see. I can't borrow from the black economy. I can't borrow from the parallel economy. So I work with the legal GDP. And as long as the underestimation is constant, I'm okay. 3% is very simple. I go back to my financial savings. So financial savings, if they're at 11, and if the government of India is borrowing today 3.5, and the state governments are borrowing 3.2, that's 6.7, and the public sector is borrowing 2, central public, that's 8.7, that leaves me with 3.2% for the private sector, whole corporate private sector, plus 4% foreign, which is all going to the private sector, corporate. 7.2% investment, you're not going to get 7% growth. Right? So I need to bring this down. And then the judgment becomes, by how much can I bring it down? So if you look at the other side, given what I've told you about the revenue deficit at the central government level and the need to maintain public capital formation, I cannot go down below 3% at the state government level. And I really, in the FRB, we have said don't change, that's a different matter. That we have a problem there, but we don't change the state government debt numbers, keep them constant at 21% if they have attained that, and if they are higher, then leave them alone. Central government, because of the revenue deficit problem, and the fact that most of it is for borrowing, maximum I can reduce my revenue deficit, which you will agree is not, is we calculate in the FRBM to 28% of total deficit. So reducing it to 28% will give you from 3.5 to about 2.93. Usse niche hum nahi kar sakte, that's the problem, on the niche side. It's not fast-paced.
Do you think that debt non-neutrality can be a worry for the Keynesians in the context of fiscal deficit unity?
How do you answer non-neutrality?
No, this is actually the method of financing the deficit. And are we looking for perfect substitutability of the taxes for debt?
Oh, no, not at all. It again, as I said, there's a political economy. It depends on your view of the size of the state. So the first thing is that if you believe that the size of the state should be larger than it is, then ideally you should get it through taxes. Because of the reasons I mentioned, I've given you four or five reasons why debt crowds out by increasing the price of private resources in the long term. But if you don't, then if you believe that the exchange position is correct, then there is no particular problem, because you see, the total, we don't print money in this country and we don't borrow from foreigners. So the total borrowing that happens from gross domestic saving, right? So whether that, and because we're capital scarce, that gross domestic saving at a particular price is either used by public sector or by households and firms. So, and roughly households and firms pay a premium of about 2%, 200 basis points on what the government gets. The government gets money cheaper, and therefore you can even allow them lower productivity compared to households and firms and what they borrow, but not that much lower than 2%. That is one. There's no problem of regarding equivalence. It's the opposite. This is an important insight. So when you're in a developing economy, typically older generations who are doing the borrowing today have worse lives than younger generations. So actually it's okay if future generations pay off the debt of present generations. It's the reverse. Because the quality of life of a generation, his generation, and the quality of life of that young woman's generation, our assumption is that given Indian growth, her quality of life will be superior to his quality of life. So actually, it's okay for him to borrow from the future. So even in terms of intertemporal neutrality, there is no theoretical problem.
Last two questions, one from the lady there, and one gentleman is right to share. After the lady.
Sir, I am a single parent of a mentally retarded child. So he survived for me and I am surviving for him. I had applied for the pension. The state pension, monthly pension, and it was given only for 12 months in the computerized system. Before that also I had applied, they told me you just forget about that manual for this one, this will be going to remain because it is computerized. I just got for 12 months, after that I did not get at all for 8 years. For 5 years I struggled, I wanted to fight, my speed was hard. I went till the chief commissioner in Delhi, step by step by step. I went to the commissioner of Karnataka, disabilities commissioner, he called the Tashildar, and then the court was held, whether it was a real or fake, I don't know, because work was not done. So I applied, I thought even commissioner is not, cannot do justice. So I wrote to the chief commissioner in Delhi. Chief commissioner wrote back that this is a state subject, you have to again come back to commissioner. But I already lost hope with our commission, state, all the state level. Or from grassroots to, so whom should I approach? I'm talking with on behalf of all the mentally retarded. I mean, so many.
I agree, madam, but this is not relevant to the story. But I'll talk to you later after this is over. I'll put you across to the concerned secretary there, and I'll give you her number. I'll speak to her. You can meet her tomorrow. The gentleman in the light blue shirt.
Hello, sir. The common man's perception is black money and corruption is affecting the state of economy in our country. So as a common person, I want to know how these fiscal deficit numbers, like 3.5%, 4%, whether how it is really affected by these factors, whether I think how government is playing the role in that.
Well, the fiscal deficit is not, I think there are two ways of looking at this question. One is that the greater the proportion of, let me not call it black money, not for any other reason than it is not helpful in answering your question. Let me call it unaccounted income. It ties up with what Professor Deshpande was saying. So you have accounted GDP and unaccounted GDP. Now the higher the proportion of unaccounted GDP, the lower the available total collective resources to do the things we want to do as a nation. Right? So if you like, fraternal expenditure is not possible to the extent that you have a higher amount of unaccounted money. It may have its own benefits, it may have its own economy, but it is not something that we are going to be part of. The second element to that is the extent to which, I think this is something that is an elephant in the room which nobody ever asks. To what extent is it the case that the existence of a large state results in the creation of unaccounted income? A large state of the type we have. Right? Here I can tell you two things which are difficult, because as I keep saying, this has to go into economic sociology. It is impossible for the large state to contribute to unaccounted income without the active cooperation of non-state actors. Here you see, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to take 2 minutes to answer this. It's a very important question. It's strongly about, again, it's another seminar. You and I, you're older than me, sir, but I'm old enough now. When I was born in 1966, I grew up in a rationed economy. Right? Everything was rationed. I don't know, people here may not remember. Everything was rationed. Food was rationed, clothing was rationed, scooter was rationed, car was rationed, airline tickets were rationed, railway tickets were rationed, bus tickets were rationed. You know, my whole life was rationed. But it was fraternal in the sense that everybody was rationed. Even a Mercedes was rationed. You had to go and buy it from HTC. So, okay. And in that economy, there were 3 ways you could escape the rationing. One was the option I chose, get out of this game, exit, go abroad, out of Russia. Second was become an engineer, chartered accountant, and become part of the people who benefit from the rationing. Third was join the civil service and become the rationer. So anything you did in this country in those days to make money was rents. Rents involved, therefore, a contract to escape rationing. So the point, as I say, is in India was not to join a queue, but to jump into. So when you jump queues, you get rents. So socially, what we have been doing is we are rent seeking. It's not just that. We have been queue jumping and jumping rationing. That has created that. Now what do you see today? Today is my life rationing? Not much. I can go abroad when I want, no foreign exchange rationing. I can buy a car off the shelf, I can buy a scooter off the shelf. If you're poor, of course your life is rationed. Ration DPT, ration gas, ration food, ration this, ration that. So now we don't have fraternal rationing anymore. But therefore, the system of rationing and rents has not gone away. It may have gone away from our lives, but it has not gone away from everybody else's life, from the vast majority of the people. Therefore, you have black money and corruption, and insofar as the state ultimately is responsible for rationing, which is why you have so much government in India, despite having so little governance, it's not illogical. You have lots of government in India because you still have, for the vast majority of people, a rationed economy. We have forgotten what a rationed economy is like because our lives are not rationed. You know, my scotch was rationed, my cigarettes were rationed, my soap was rationed, my Tang was rationed, my Coke was rationed. All that now I can get. I just have to walk out, I can get everyone, buy a ticket to New York, pick up $10,000 foreign exchange and go. But the guy who has to get his food is still doing DBT, gas cylinder, power is rationed for the poor, right? Everything is rationed for the poor. When you have rationing, you have rents. So our lives, we have exited rationing. When you have rents, then the state will be part of the system that creates black money. So until we get out of this rationing, and the only way you will do it is if you are able to produce our growth such that we produce the things that all Indians consume in a fashion where they are no longer rationed. Why is healthcare rationed for the poor? Why do I need all this bloody healthcare, insurance, this, that? Because they can't afford to buy healthcare at quality. Why is education rationed? Why is housing rationed? Why do I need all this wretched corruption creating Bangalore Development Authority, whatever it's called, Delhi Development Authority and the curses? Because they're rationing instruments. So until that rationing stops, we'll have a state. And when you have a state that is administering rationing, you will have corruption, but it is not a matter of the state. You can't clean up the state. You have to clean up the non-state actors involved in rationing. And that you can't do unless you change the game. That's the reason why black money and corruption impact the ability of the state to function effectively. So it's really an argument for a more egalitarian pattern of growth. Then you will have a more effective state that is not in the business of rationing. Then you will have less corruption. Otherwise, you're going to go on hitting the symptoms. Yes, I'm sub chore is not going to work. You understand?
Thank you, Rathin. And very patiently, you have answered all the questions. Thank you very much. And we all value your insights into this whole topic. And we're grateful you spent some time with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So thank you, Rathin, for your brilliant lecture. I was actually, I had several questions probably over dinner. And one of them actually was that why can't we aspire for a European kind of social welfare state? And there the larger state also becomes more desirable. So some other time. And thank you, Mr. Ayas and Prasad, for chairing it and agreeing to chair despite your reluctance. And thank you all, my colleagues and everybody else who is here. And also for asking questions which made the lecture even more interesting. And so that's it. Thanks. See, every year we come here. This is the venue. And every year we come with a new speaker. We'll have another endowment lecture this year on health on 11th of May. So we'll come back here for that. Thanks.